kia ora rā tātou, tātou I hui hui mai tēnei wā. Ka tukuna te rākau kia haunei kia whakatūwhera te wiki nei, ko tērā nā mahi maumahara I te whetatanga o te mahi maina kaura I roto I tēnei rohe. I te tuatahi, ka karakia, kia tūwhera ai tō tātou nei hui hui nga. Mai e te tupua, mai e te tāwhito, mai e te kāhui o ngā reki, mai e te kāhui o ngā tanifa. Tā whiwhi atu ki ngā tua ko rangi nui ki runga ko papatua naku ki raro. Kaupare atu ngā kino o te wā, kaupare atu ngā puke o te wā. Kia whakawā tia te ara takatū o tāne whakapiripiri. Tēnei te pau o tupu ānuku, tēnei te pau o tupu ārangi. Kā whakamaua ki uta, kā whakamaua ki tai, kā whakamaua tūturu, tūturu whakamaua kia tīnā. Haumie, hui e, tai. Kia ora rā tātou.
Yeah. very much, Thames High School and South School. Good afternoon and welcome to this afternoon's civic reception and to recognise the proclamation of gold 150 years ago at Thames today, the 1st of August 1967. My name is Alan Judd and I will be your MC for this afternoon. Maybe I should be more precise with my name. It is in fact Roger Alan Charles Judd. Now, Charles Judd comes from my great-great-grandfather on my father's side. Charles Judd was reported to be the first man to cast iron on the Harrogate Goldfields on the 2nd of September 1869. He came to Thames as a trader, sailing around the shores, and he came into Thames on his boat and he saw the need for the repair and manufacture of heavy machinery, the gold, and also the log hauling machinery that was here in Thames. So it was the start of a very successful engineering business that grew in Thames over the years. This afternoon we're going to hear from a number of people, the schools, Monetary, South School, St Francis, Parawai, Thames High School. We're going to have our dignitaries from Mosaki as well, Konnichiwa. We will also hear from the Mayor, Sandra Gowdy, and also from Diane Connors from the Community Board. We'll be hearing from our finalists in the song contests, as well as joining me on the couch will be Rosalie Stewart and Russell Skeet to share some of their knowledge and history of Thames. Firstly though, I would like to read out a message that was sent to me by Scott Simpson. He is the MP for Coromandel and unfortunately can't be here today. To my fellow Thamesites, I am sorry that I am unable to join in the celebrations today and as I am required to be in Wellington in Parliament. Today marks the start of the sequential celebrations of the establishment of the township we know and love as Thames. Many stories have been told, written and reminisced of the gold rush fever that spread throughout the country. Many of our ancestors poured into Thames to try their luck. Thousands of miners digging, hard-working toilers, whose prosperous dreams of riches often only produced calloused hands and profound hardship. I would like to thank those who have preserved the history, the many hours spent collating, collecting and cataloguing so that we may enjoy and celebrate the milestones. I acknowledge the Thames Coromandel District Council, Thames Community Board, Ngāti Maru, Thames Heritage Trust, the Treasury, Hauraki Prospectors Association, Thames local businesses, and the many volunteers whose commitment and contribution to our community celebration does not go unnoticed. Thank you for your influence and support. Thames has a rich history, and it's a special privilege to be able to mark this 150th anniversary with you from afar. There are plenty of community events planned, and I am looking forward to attending lots of them. I hope to see you there. Scott Simpson, the Honourable Scott Simpson, I should say, MP for Coromandel. Now it is my pleasure to welcome to this stage who worship the Mayor, Sandra Gowdy, and Diane Connors, Chair of the Community Board. How are you? Good. Come and join me on the couch. Thank you, ladies. It's a pleasure to have you here. Firstly, I'd just like to acknowledge the sponsorship of the Thames Coromandel District Council and what they have done to help us bring all this together. It is a real pleasure and a privilege to have the sponsorship of your council. So thank you very much, Sandra. I'd like to start with you, Sandra, and ask what you see as being the biggest benefit for Thames in celebrating the proclamation of the Goldfields. Right up to the mouth. Pretend it's an ice cream, Sandra.
Is it going? Hello? Is that going? Hello. Is that going? No. Oh, great. Isn't that marvellous? Hello? That's... Oh, they're both going? Excellent.
Now we've got you talking. Where we go, Sandra?
Well, I think it's just so wonderful to celebrate our heritage. And it's so important to us because it shows us where we've been. And you can see the children down here in these wonderful heritage costumes. And I love it. You all look absolutely fantastic. And then we look at the children that are not in heritage costume. And don't you just see that incredible change? And that's what's so exciting about celebrating the past and also celebrating the present and acknowledging the past. So it's about going forward. Change is always happening. Things do change, but I think it's important to hang on to what we have known in the past. It is very important going forward. It's very important to us here in Thames. We have the Stamper Battery, and it is one of our highest domestic earners for visitor numbers and tourists coming into the town. So awfully important to us economically.
Thanks, Sandra. I mean, how can we learn from mistakes of the past to ensure a happy and prosperous future?
Well, I think we've made incredible strides environmentally so that we don't go and pollute our rivers and our waterways and that we look after our bush environment. And I think that the young people of today, they all understand that. You all love your environment and plant trees and things like that, don't you? So I think that's we've made some incredible strides in that regard.
Yes, well, I certainly know from myself as a wee boy growing up in Tararua, the mud flats that used to be across the road, and now I look at it as I drive down the coast and we've got wonderful sandy beaches back there again, so that really has improved the environment. So thank you very much for that, Sandra. If I can ask Diane, as Chair of the Thames Community Board, how's the board gone about offering support to the heritage groups of Thames?
Thank you for that, Alan. The Thames Community Board knew that this centenary was coming up, or tricentennial, whatever it's called. And we put some provision in our budgets about 2 years ago to make sure that we had some funds available to help organisations who wanted to do things for the 150th. And we are very aware that our heritage is a big part of our visitor attraction. And so we wanted to make sure that we were able to help out those organisations that are providing an attraction where people get to actually stop and listen and look and experience what our past was all about. And we do that very well in Thames. And so we were able to help out organisations like the Hauraki Prospectors Association, who have now got a Stamper Battery up and working, which will be launched by this lovely lady here on Saturday. And she'll hit the button. And that's great to have that going again. We've also put some funding into them getting a stationary steam engine on site in the future too. So really exciting to see those sort of things going on. And of course, we've invested into our treasury, the Bella Street Pump House, and also our museum, which has got some new displays. And please go down and see their little miniature cinema. It's just brilliant. And we have some wonderful stories from Rosalie Stewart there. So if you haven't been down there, please go down and check it out.
Can I just add on that Diane is Chair of the Thames Community Board, and Marlene and all of the Thames Network people, I mean, I know you said it before, but they have just done an amazing job. So well done on all your efforts. It's just been absolutely awesome. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for those kind words, Sandra.
It's not just us, though. I mean, we really just help coordinate and promote what's going on, and what we're really excited about is the fact that the schools and the community organisations are really getting in behind it. So we thank you guys for participating and adding it to your curriculums and helping the younger people understand a bit about the importance of our history and why we are the way we are today because of the events that came before.
Gold.
Thank you very much for that, Diane. You answered the second question, which I was going to ask about what special events have been organised. But I'm going to move on. What do you see as the strengths of Thames going forward into the future?
I still see us as a really strong hub of the whole region. Thames needs to have a strong economy for the rest of the region to do really well, and it's really good that that's been acknowledged at council level. But I think it's really about the people. The more I hear from people coming to our town recently, we've had quite a few new families move down from Auckland and other places around, and I always ask, you know, what made you decide to come and live here in Thames? Why our town? What attracted you here? And the common answer that comes back is that they've been here for another reason, to visit family or for an event that was on, and just fell in love with the people. And it's always been the same answer, that while they appreciate the lovely setting that we have and the beautiful buildings and the activities that we have going on here, it's the friendliness of the people that really attracts people. And I say that is one of our biggest strengths, and we'll do what we can to make sure that we have the best, coolest people in Thames River.
Thank you very much for that wonderful insight, ladies, and thanks for sharing your thoughts and visions for Thames and its 150th anniversary celebrations. Ladies and gentlemen, who worship the Mayor, Sandra Gowdy, and Chair of the Community Board, Diane Connors.
Thank you, Graham Norton.
Thank you, ladies. Just while they're leaving the stage, I'd just like to acknowledge sponsorship also from Mitre 10. They are one of the major sponsors of our celebrations today. It's now my pleasure to welcome to the stage our finalists in the song contest. We have Estelle Cashmore, Sean Kelly, and Andy McCaskill. Estelle's going to join me on the couch and have a few words about her song which she wrote for Sean. He is going to be performing her song. So, Estelle, if you'd like to come and join me up here on the couch, it'd be a pleasure to have a few words with you. Hello, Estelle, and welcome. Please grab a seat there. It's lovely to see you here this afternoon. The first song that we're about to hear was written by you, Estelle, and it's a band of family's Irish beginnings. Tell us about the meaning of the song.
Well, I wrote this song because, in common with a lot of people in Thames, I have an Irish ancestry, and my ancestors came here in the 1864, I think it was, and joined the Gold Rush. And things were very poor in Ireland at the time, and you will hear that in the song, that things were very poor and people were forced to leave the country of their birth because there was not enough food and there was not enough jobs, and their country was occupied, and they thought, we have to get out of here and give our children a better life. So that's what the song is about finding a better life for their families.
Yeah, I suppose it would have been pretty hard back in Ireland in the 1860s and that, and yeah, anything that they could do for that better life would certainly be a step up, I suppose, from where they'd come from. I mean, it would have been pretty hard days back in the mines back in the UK.
It was not easy to get to New Zealand either. I had a 16-year-old great-aunt who was 16 when she left Ireland. Her family never knew if she was going to be seen or heard of again. And she sailed on a sailing ship which took 3 weeks to get...
Three months
to get here. Unaccompanied. I think, how many 16-year-old girls can do that these days? It's just amazing what these people did.
Yeah, they were pretty sturdy sort of a people back then, weren't they? Hey, well, let's hear from Sean Kelly and your song that you wrote for him.
My old family's Irish, fled from Ireland. They had no way to make ends meet, so they had to leave their land. In the 1800s, their land was very poor. The Irish were a problem, had to be outlawed. Crops had failed, the people starved, they knew not what to do. The farmers were evicted, and their families all went too. But a few brave souls had had enough of the their landlords, they were too tough. They sought to find another place to bring their children up, to bring their children up. They jumped on ships and sailed off to places far away, America and New Zealand. Adventures come what may. Lived and worked far, far from their native shore. Now they could feed their children, so they were poor no more. A few brave souls had enough. Them landlords were too tough. They sought to find another place to bring their children up, to bring their children. Intends to join the gold rush. It was exciting times. Now it's 150 years since they worked them mines. To celebrate our history and have a bit of fun, events are planned for everyone and turn everyone. Brave souls that had enough. All them landlords, they were too tough. They fought to find another place to bring their children up, to bring their children up. My old family's Irish, they fled from Ireland. Times were tough, they had enough, so they had to leave their land. Come down, ah, Tyrone, and the further Thames, New Zealand, New Zealand, ah, Tyrone, and the further Thames.
Thank you very much, Groomy and my Huggins.
Thank you very much, Sean. What a wonderful rendition that was of such a moving and inspirational song. You must be very proud, Estelle. It's certainly fabulous.
Thank you very much, Sean. I really appreciate you doing that for me. Thank you,
Estelle. Yeah. Now, it's time to hear from Sean again with one of his own songs. Now, Sean started with rock bands in London, and currently these days he performs with the Celtic Flyers, New Zealand's top Irish show band. So ladies and gentlemen, I give you again, Sean Kelly.
Thank you. This is a wee song called I'm a Long Way From Home. Similar to Estelle's song. It was about Irish immigrants and other immigrants who came to New Zealand, and particularly the Goldfields. A lot of them came to Thames. I live up the Waiatahi Valley. And my name's, surname's Kelly. And I found a map that dates back to 1870, and there was lots of Kellys living up the Waiatahi Valley. So how I ended up here is, I think it's fate. I'm a long way from home, but the crack is still good. In a big town called Thames in New Zealand, the Maori find gold in a crystal clear stream. Since then we have come from all over the world. You know the work's bloody hard, cause the gold's all in quartz. We're digging for gold dawn through the dusk. At the weekend we came at the Brian Brew, where we dance and we drink and we meet ladies too. And in February when the snow falls hard back home, the sun it burns down here and burns skin brown. But from a hole in the ground, well it ain't that sunny when we're digging for gold up in Madman's Gully. I'm a long way from home, but from the names of the plots, Have you believed somehow you're not? Shannon, Simon, Kerry and Star of Fermanagh, the Rose and Shamrock and Fogabala. You know the Paddies and the Maury, we work hard for the crack. After a day in the mines, you can't tell us apart. But the pay that we get, it don't make us feel rich. Come Monday, we're skint and we're back on the pick. And I'm a long way from home, but the crack is still good. In a big town called Thames in New Zealand, at the Maori found gold in a crystal clear stream. Since then we have come from all over the world. Yeah, the Maori found gold in a crystal clear stream. Since then we have come from all over.
Thank you very much, Kermit. Thank you, Sean, for such a wonderful and moving song. It was a pleasure to hear it, and congratulations on being a finalist in the song contest.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, Sean Cullen. I'd also like to welcome to the stage now, take a seat there, still, and listen to the next song. I'd like to welcome to the stage now Andy McCaskill. Now, Andy is a well-known Thames person. He's one of Thames' true gems. Not only is Andy a wonderfully talented man, but he's also a writer and musician, but is also the father of a very well-known New Zealand playwright, Jamie McCaskill. And Jamie has written a wonderful play that was based here in the Junction Hotel of Thames, based around a fishing contest called The Biggest. I'll let you make of that what you like. But Masaki children, when you're going fishing tomorrow at Coromandel, you'll catch a fish and it'll be about yay big, but by the time you get home and tell the story, the fish will be yay big. Andy, what a pleasure it is to have you here. You've been singing now for some 40 years. You've produced or released 4 albums to date. But this song has hit a note, and excuse the pun, it's all about the Thames history. Tell me more about your influence of growing up, and where did the words come from for the song?
I'm just proud to be a Thames person, and when I was told about the songwriting competition, I thought, oh well, I wrote a song about Thames, and there's a song by James Taylor that goes, in my mind I'm going to Carolina, and I thought, in my mind I'll go back in time. And so in my mind I went back in time and wrote what I thought it would have been like. And that's about it.
Andy, we look forward to hearing the song. Good as. Ladies and gentlemen, Andy McCaskill.
Some old gold mine, far away in some old mining town. And the thumping of machinery, it's just the way things used to be, as another empty wagon rumbles down. And I get a sense of history, nostalgia comes right over me. Look around at a town that's young and free. And all the blood and sweat and tears of 150 years make me think about how this town used to be. As I think back further yet, you know the Maori were here and we can't forget their way of life and the culture that they taught. And through their generosity, this town was built beside the sea. side by side through many wars we've fought. And I get a sense of history, nostalgia comes right over me. I look around at a town that's young and free, and all the blood and sweat and tears of 150 years makes me think about how this town used to be. Within my reach, watch graceful seabirds as they fly, and I think of those who've come and gone. Some have lost and some have won. All I know is just how hard they tried. And I get a sense of history, nostalgia comes right over me. I look around at a town that's young and free, that's Thames. And all the blood and sweat and tears of 150 years makes me think about how this town used to be. It makes me think about how this town used to be.
Thank you, Andy, Sean, and yourself. Thank you very much for coming. It is now my pleasure, and I'm hoping that this man here is on the, in the audience. I haven't seen him yet. Darren Jenkins from Ngāti Maru. Are you here, Darren? Doesn't look like he is. Not a problem. Darren has been creating a wonderful sculpture for Thames, a po. It is stone, it is wrought iron, and it is wood. It's very much in its creation stage at the moment. Darren has been building this down at the Ngāti Maru headquarters, I suppose you'd call them, the old railway station here of Thames, and it's a wonderful piece that is waiting to be unveiled. I know that they're waiting for resource consent to decide exactly where the piece is going to go. And from my understanding, I believe, Sandra, if this is correct, down by the Centennial Pool. No? Has it changed again, has it? There we go. Going south of the Kauranga Bridge, and it should be up by the end of the month. So thank you to the council for getting that organised. It would have been wonderful to have had it unveiled this morning, but unfortunately that wasn't to be. But when it is unveiled, it's going to be a wonderful piece for the people of Thames and the visitors to go and see, and to recognise where Thames has come from in the last 150 years. We were just a small town. We will hear from Rosalie and Russell to get more of an understanding of that aspect. We're now going to hear from our friends at Moana Taieri School. Now, it gives me great pleasure to introduce to the stage Moana Taieri School. I was a foundation pupil there myself in 1972. Moana Taieri School started from the amalgamation of Thames Central School in town here, North School, which was out at Tararu, and Kōpū School, obviously to the south at Kōpū. Their principal is Dave Brook, who tells me the school song was composed by Isaac Gurney. Moana Taieri is a bicultural school, and their song represents the rivers, mountains, sea, and the colonial history of the indigenous people. So if we welcome to the stage, please, Moana Taieri School.
Moana Taieri, Moana Taieri, Moana Taieri. golden Thames. Many years later now the children are the gems. We all have the right to learn and be safe. Our time in school's so short, so you better not waste it. The future is golden, the Karanga. There's nowhere I'd rather be. Moana Taiari. There's between the forests and mountains and the sea. Moana Taiari. Ako is the way we expand what we know. Lighting my fire as we teach, learn and grow. Kakao te for each other, we deserve respect. Treat me like I treat you, that's what we can expect. The future is calling me Karanga. There's nowhere I'd rather be. No one at Tayani. Between the forests and mountains and the sea. Moana Taiani. This is where I do my kapai te mahi. Moana Taiani. This is where I hear my nakitanga. Moana Taiani. Working together, whaka whananga tanga. Moana Taiari. Being the best we are, tino paraua. Moana Taiari, Moana Taiari, Moana Taiari.
What a wonderfully stirring performance that was, and how wonderful it was to hear that song. And I've got to say how nice it is to see you kids all in school uniforms. When I was there in 1972, we wore mufti to school every day. We got away with wearing jandals too, though. I have such fond memories of attending at Monotaro School. I was lucky enough to represent the school in many, many sports. But to turn up at Monotaro School in 1972 as a wee six-year-old boy to find my name plastered all over the school, I thought that was pretty cool actually. We wandered around the school and here was all these manhole covers with the name Charles Judd written on them. And as I said my name, Roger Allen Charles Judd, and I thought, this is quite cool, a six-year-old boy wandering around school and my name's graffitied all over the place already. And now it gives me great pleasure to bring to the stage Rosalie Stewart. Now, Rosalie is a storyteller of great note with many magnificent tales of the bygone eras of Thames. So welcome to the stage, Rosalie. Come on, come and join me. Welcome, Rosalie. It's a pleasure to have you here on the stage and to hear some of your wonderful stories. Tell me about the early days of the development of Thames after Captain James Cook had sailed the HMS Endeavour into the Firth of Thames in 1769.
Well, it's very difficult to tell a story like that sitting down because it was so exciting. I mean, Hauraki was the first place in New Zealand where the Endeavour actually got a peaceful welcome. Because the very powerful tangata whenua would always send out a haka crew whenever anybody strange showed up. But by the time he came to Hauraki, Tikapa Moana, all of the people knew that they were here in peace and they just wanted water and they wanted food and they were looking to explore. And so Hauraki gave the Endeavour and Captain Cook a really great welcome. And so then, what happened after that? There was so much to tell. We've only got a few minutes, haven't we? But I want to take us back to the 1st of August, 1867. It was pouring. It was pouring with rain. It was so heavy rain that the first Enterprise, number two, that was ready to bring 150 miners over here, well, it couldn't even leave the ferry in Auckland. It stayed there until the afternoon. And by the time it left in the afternoon and then got to the landing, well,
wasn't a wharf there, was it? No, it was a mud flat, and nobody could get ashore because it was pitch dark and it was a sea of mud. And so the first thing that happened was nobody could get here. That's part of what happened. But I want to tell you what it was like in Auckland, why so many people were desperate that there be a gold field. Because it was starving people over there. People were being seen on the streets, so starving they'd passed out and some even died. So there was a lot of desperate people who wanted to have some way to survive. And so when they heard that the Māori people, Ngāti Maru, had found gold, everybody's hopes just lifted. They thought, what if we could find gold? What if we could strike it lucky and we could become wealthy beyond our dreams? It was like buying a lotto ticket and being sure that you were going to win. So that's how exciting it was. And so people just rushed over here on the ferries, boatload after boatload. And man, it was real muddy up there. And there was fleas and rats and it was freezing and they were in their tents and it was pouring rain. And on the first day, they couldn't even go hunting for gold because the rivers were running too fast, the Karaka and the Hape. So it was very exciting times, I can tell you.
And I suppose no electricity in those days, so they couldn't turn the heater on or turn the flick the computer on and surf the net or anything, could they?
Not at all, not at all. In fact, they actually used to get a whiskey bottle and take the top off and turn it upside down and stick a candle in it and have it on a piece of wire, and that was how they would get around at night. So they had a little bit of light. It was a broken candle and a broken bottle with a piece of wire. Talk about number eight wire. Right back then it was.
Thank you, Rosalie. So when did the missionaries arrive and what purpose did they serve when they got here?
Well, they first got here in 1833. Now, there's a whole lot of story around that, but you know, because as I was saying, the Tangata Whenua were a very fierce people in those days, and it was all very well because chiefs would fight chiefs and great warriors would fight great warriors, but then the Europeans bought the muskets. And so that meant that a useless warrior who could just aim straight could kill a mighty chief from a great distance. And so the fighting was so bad that they actually needed to find a way to stop killing each other as much as they were with the muskets. That was called the Musket Wars, as you know. And so the chiefs who were here, they decided that those missionaries had something to do to bring peace between the tribes. And so they invited the missionaries to come here in 1833 so that the Tangata Whenua, the local people, could start to learn to read and write, and that they could start to learn the Christian message of actually forgiving people, because they didn't know that piece of technology in those days.
Thank you for that, Rosie. Well, now, we'll come back to you shortly. It's now time to hear from another of our schools. The next item to be performed is from the Parawai School. Now, the principal at Parawai School is Dave Hills, and he tells me the school was opened in 1967. Now, I have fond memories of competing in the inter-school cross-countries at Parawai School every year, and a very hard course it was out there too. The item they are performing for us today is a dance that represents the school and its transformation.
This year our town is celebrating its heritage. Our school is also celebrating our heritage this year at the school's 50th Jubilee. We are looking forward to investigating not only how the town has changed, but how schools have changed as well. If you are interested in joining in the 50th Jubilee celebrations at Parawai School in October, contact our school office. This performance showcases just one way that schooling has changed in the last 50 years. We hope you enjoy it.
Gotta get that. Gotta get that. Gotta get that. Gotta get that.
Got the chick I call it Lola. She feel like the ocean, like to drink and smoke some Doja. And I feel like smoking, plus she good at charming cobras. I feel like I'm chosen, but she ain't the only one.
Booty rolling. I just wanna rollie, rollie, rollie with a dapper ranch.
Percocet, Miley Percocet, Percocet, Miley Percocet, represent, gotta represent. Chase a chick, never chase a chick, no mask on, get mask on.
Nothing can stop me, I'm all the way up, all the way up.
Okay. I got a Glock in my arm.
Love in a thousand different flavors. I wish that I could taste them all night.
My left stroke just went viral.
Right stroke put a baby in a spiral. Soprano C, we like to keep it on the high note. Levels to it, you and I know. Tell them be humble.
Hold up.
Sit down.
Hold up.
Be humble.
Hold up.
Sit down.
Sit down.
Be humble.
Hold up.
Sit down.
Hold
up. Be humble.
Hold up.
Sit down.
Hold up.
Be humble.
Hold up.
Hold up. Sit down.
Wow, what an amazing inspirational performance there was. Thank you very much, Parowise School. And I'd just like to wish you all the very best for your 50th anniversary celebrations, or birthday, that you're going to be celebrating later this year. Parowise School, as it stands on the site that it is today. I mean, if we could carry on now, Rosalie, we were talking about the coming together, the Maori and the Europeans. How did they get on with negotiating terms of trade leading up to the signing of the Treaty of Waitangi?
Well, in fact, Hauraki got one of the first examples of the potato from Captain Cook in 1769. And so when the next ships came along, then they had potato as well as fish to be able to trade with all the boats that came by. Now, I have to say that the European captains were often very badly behaved, that they would think that it was just their place, and they would land on shore, and they would go and help themselves to the trees, and they would take things because they thought they were just wild, but actually they weren't wild, they were territory that belonged to the different tribes. And so there was a few things that got out of control there, understandably. But Māori were very active in trading both to all the ships that came by and then afterwards to the settlers that came to the different parts.
Yes, I know Russell's going to touch more on this shortly. So thank you very much for that, Rosalie. It's been very insightful, and I look forward to hearing many more of your tales over the coming months as
thank
we celebrate
you,
the 150 years.
Good to have you here. Our descendants knew each other.
Yes, apparently they did. Ladies and gentlemen, Rosalie Stewart. It is now my pleasure to welcome to the stage the visiting group from the Japanese sister city of Misaki. Konnichiwa. A welcome to New Zealand, Aotearoa, land of the long white cloud. Misaki is located in the north of the main island of Honshu, about 60 kilometres inland of the eastern seaboard. Now, it has a population of approximately 15,000 people, and their main source of employment is food production. The city is also well known for mining of the phosphorus, and this is the connection that Thames and Misaki have. So ladies and gentlemen, I give you Misaki School.
Soran is a traditional folk song in Hokkaido.
they dance to this song at the festival. The dance expresses the joy of a high, big catch of a herring. The highlight of this dance are big movement and encouragement.
Up!
I hope you all enjoy it as much as I did. This group will be in Thames for the next week or so, so if you see them around, please do make them feel very welcome. And as I said to you earlier, please enjoy your trip to Coromandel tomorrow, then getting out on the mussel barge and going fishing. It's now I'm very thrilled to bring to the stage an old compadre and Thames historian, Russell Skeet. Now, Russell is the face behind Reed's Hardware, who have been an institution in Thames since 1867. As I started to mention before, I'm very thrilled now to welcome to the stage an old compadre and Thames historian, Russell Skeet. Now, Russell is the face behind Reed's Hardware, who have been an institution in Thames since 1867. Not that I'm saying Russell's been there that long. Russell is also one of Thames's greatest historians, and I welcome you here today to share some of your knowledge, Russell.
Thank you. I appreciate that, or I rather suspect that was a bit bigger than it needed to be.
Yeah. Tell me, Russell, there are a lot of negotiations that went on behind the scenes between the Maoris and the Europeans prior to the goldfields being opened. What are the main concerns of the Maoris, and who were their leaders leading the charge for them to have this gold proclamation?
That's an interesting question. I'm not going to answer it just at the moment. What I want to do is just congratulate the kids that are here today. This is fantastic. If we had any worries about the future, they've gone now, because what we're seeing is just the most magnificent example of youth and energy. So can we just give them a really big round of applause? I don't think we've got anything to worry about. But I do also want to just inject a small note of somberness, I guess. 146 years ago, when Thames ONG Price started. Last week, they went into liquidation. I'd like us to spare just a moment to reflect on the 100 families that's affected. So if we could just pause for a moment from our celebratory mode and just think of those 100 families. Thank you. Appreciate that. The question was, what were the concerns of the Māori coming into the negotiation? Well, you can imagine, if you know anything about the history of Thames, that they had a number of quite substantial concerns. One of the major concerns was the loss of land. Another concern was the regulation of the goldfield. How was this going to play out? And a third significant concern, and it resonates today, is guaranteed income from whatever arrangements might be made. And so it is that we begin to understand the reality for Māori in those days, which was that they had been there before. 1852, the famous goldfield discovered in Coromandel didn't amount to much. Comes back in 64, splutters along. Māori are introduced to the Pākehā way of doing things. Their concerns were validated to some extent in the dealings that they had with the Auckland provincial government. And so they had cause for concern, as I say, and so those were primarily the things that they had uppermost in their mind. What about the land? What about the governance, the regulation? What about the money? Nothing much changes over time. You can understand that from their perspective, they have a huge asset and they want to make certain that they're in control of what happens to that asset. Ellen asked the question, who were the people that were involved? I just need to get my book. We talk mostly of Ngāti Maru these days. We need to remember that there were other tribes in the area. Ngāti Tamatara, Ngāti Maru of course, Ngāti Whanaunga, Ngāti Poa, Te Tauara, Ngāti Parauru. This group of tribes constituted about 1,900 or 2,000 people from the top of Coromandel down to Ohinamuri and through into Hauraki. So there's a reasonably significant group of people, and they were led by some quite visionary people. Top of that particular list was Hauru Hotelini Taipiri, the senior Taipiri, with his son Wiripi Hotelini Taipiri. They were visionary. They were prescient in as much as they understood what was going to happen when Pākehā took over the land and opened the goldfield. They were supported by a couple of others, though. Rapana Monganoa was a good friend of Taipiri's. Raika Whakarangatai was another one. Te Meramana Kōnui. Those were the principal chiefs that were involved, principal rangatira that were involved in negotiating with the other side, which was the Superintendent John Williamson of the Auckland Provincial Government, his very able and capable deputy, Dr. Daniel Pollen, and of course the inimitable Civil Commissioner James Mackay, the Canny Scot, who was responsible for the majority of the negotiation. But if you think it was plain sailing, think again. There was a lot of opposition to opening these lands for goldfield. And that opposition was driven by a couple of particularly sticky individuals who were equally adamant that this wasn't going to happen. Aparana Te Roiroa was one of them. Riwai was another one. Sorry, red book. Te Hira and Taria Te Raia. Individuals that had some concerns and challenged Taipiri. But with the support, of course, of Mackay and Pollen and Williamson, the deal was done and the proclamation was issued.
Just tell me, Russell, the Maoris, they must have been very sceptical about the white man coming to these shores after the recent land wars.
I don't know that I would say sceptical. They saw a very great trading opportunity. Maori were familiar with the way of the Pākehā. They had taken on a religious model given to them by the English. They had taken on an economic model given to them by the English, and they proved consummately good at working both of those models to their advantage. So I don't know that I would say sceptical. I would say they saw it as an opportunity.
They had obviously become quite economically savvy, I would think.
Well, it's very evident that they were savvy in the deal that they negotiated with the provincial government. They were certain to make good money out of the gold field. They knew that there was gold in this area from 1845, but it was proven in 1852 in Coromandel, again in 64 in Coromandel, and of course the great flash in the pan in 67 in Thames. And so they saw a wonderful opportunity that they were very quick to seize. They were very capable negotiators, and they drove a particularly hard bargain under the stewardship of Hauru Hotariri Taipiri. And they were very respected by their Pākehā counterparts for being very astute businessmen. So sceptical? No. Opportunists? Possibly. Skilled businessmen? Absolutely.
Very good. Thanks, Russell. We'll come back to that again shortly. We now have on stage and ready to perform for us very shortly the 10 South School Choir and Dance Groups. The principal from South School is Kim Nakora, who tells me their school was established in 1915. It was the original Parawai School that opened in 1876. South School will perform a dance called the Gallipoli, a folk dance. We will then hear from their choir, who will pay tribute to the dance. And well, don't these kids look amazing?
Hey!
that was incredible. I thought those costumes looked pretty cool, don't you think, Russell? I mean, some of those kids look pretty special. We're now going to hear from the Thames South School Choir performance. It's going to be conducted by Becky Armstrong and the guitar lead of Jackie Armstrong. They're going to be singing a song from The Wizard of Oz, Somewhere Over the Rainbow. This is going to be accompanied by the ukulele chorus of Janya, Cassandra, Amira, Liana, and Damien.
Together, oh, who dwell upon
was incredible. Thank you very much, South School.
I mean, I look forward to having many more words with you over the coming months. I mean, we've got a lot of celebrations coming up, and this is going to be a wonderful occasion for Thames. I know you've got a lot of speaking engagements organised around town, and I look forward to seeing some of those, emceeing, I believe, the steampunk ball at the Bella Street Pump House, is it?
Oh, yes, good advertisement. Nice segue. Thank you, Alan. Of course, don't forget the steampunk ball whenever it is later in the year. It's going to be a great event. I'm going to be there. Fantastic, yes. I want to just finish with a whakatauki from Māori, though, that I think is appropriate. He aha te kaiotia rangatira. He kōrero. What is the food of the leader? It is knowledge. It is communication. Thank you.
He tangata, he tangata, he tangata. Thank you very much, Russell. It's now time to hear from our last school of the day, St. Francis. Their principal is Geraldine Sumner. She tells me the school was one of the first to be established in what was known as Shortland in 1868. The Catholic Church had opened in Thames a year before, and Father Jordan had decided it was time to get these ragamuffin kids off the streets and into the classroom. St. Francis will be performing the Irish blessing as a tribute to the strong Irish heritage that we have in Thames today. So if we could have a warm round of applause, please, for St. Francis School. And again, don't these children look wonderful in their costumes? Thank you very much, St. Francis School, and to all the other schools who have performed today, and to all of our guest speakers who have been up here. I would like to thank you for your attendance here today and wish you and every organisation who have contributed to the festivities, who will be contributing to the festivities over the next 150 days, all the very best. It has been my pleasure to bring to you this magnificent event, and would like to thank Marlene Parry for all of her diligent organisation. I'd also like to thank Dave Greenslade for his assistance in bringing this event together today. Without your help, we wouldn't be standing here now. So thank you, Dave and Marlene. We could have a round of applause for those two, please. Just while St. Francis is leaving the stage, I'd also like to pay a wee tribute to John Galloway from Thames Auction House for loaning me the furniture that we have up here today. It's nice of him to empty out his smoker room and give me this couch. So well done, John. That, folks, concludes concludes our service for this afternoon. As I say, we've got 150 days of celebrations ahead. I know that Sandra Gowdy, the Mayor, Russell, Rosalie, they're all going to be speaking at different events throughout the coming 150 days. So I look forward to seeing you all at many events. Thank you and God bless.